Okay, hello and welcome. My name is Andrea Haandrikman. I am a visual artist and also the founder of Camino Stones, which is the project I'm talking about here today. So I choose to paint murals and paintings on canvas. And then in 2015, I started an art project with miniatures, and then everything changed. So this is me carrying out the art project in 2015, which is laying out an art route of 1,415 kilometers through France and Spain. First, I will start with telling you something more about the Camino Stones art project, then about the development of the art project, which started in 2015 and which is still going strong. And then I will start to tell you something about the technical part of the project and what it's like for a non-technical person to do a project like this and why it is an interesting journey. Okay, so first about the Camino Stone art project. It is an art project which combines arts, messages and stories and technology. And the basis of the art project is miniature paintings on stone, as you see here. Attached to these stones are labels with QR codes and web links attached to it. There are two types of stones that I paint for this project, resting stones and traveling stones. They are prepared by me in my studio, and then they are left on the national and international walking trails for other walkers to be found. When someone finds a stone like this and is curious, he thinks, wow, what does the web link tell me? And then this person discovers a message or story, and I hope he likes it. So this is the basis of the art project. The stone above is a stone of which I would love people to read it and respond, but then leave it on the spot. And the stone below is a traveling stone, which is also meant to be read and the story to be discovered. And then people can take this stone and leave it on a new location. And it's very easy for them to give me the new location using the GPS on their mobile device or also on the desktop at home. So this is very short, the basis of the art project, which is far more extended than this, but I will tell you more about it. So when someone is walking the trail, walking in nature, and he finds this miniature painted stone and is curious, he looks it up on the mobile device and then he sees this, the technical part of the project. As you see, above is some small explanation about the project, like, hey, you found a stone, it's part of an art project. Then there will be two pictures, one detailed picture of the stone, and on the right, a picture of the stone on the location, which will be this year in Belgium, France, or Spain. And below, people can read the story which is attached to the stone. And on the right, you see the option to give the new location. And below, there will be comments, hopefully pictures of stones on new locations, so the interaction of the people who let the stone travel. So this is the preparation and miniature painted stones for my next project. It will start in April this year. It's 100 miniature painted stones, which are prepared to travel with me. So behind each stone is a unique message or story. So each stone is unique. And part of these stories are stories given to me by participants in the art projects. And these are stories or messages they want to share with the world, or a story that is remarkable for them and that they like to share with the art project. So this is part of the project. Another part of the project is dedicated to endangered and vulnerable species. That is because I think it's a really interesting subject and I want people to learn more about it, but also because I like to paint miniature animals, special species. So That's part of the project. So this is a project that I will carry out this year. It will be a route laid out between Maastricht in the Netherlands and Santiago de Compostela in Spain. It's a route of 2,500 kilometers. And every day on this route, I will leave one stone and I will make it a follow-up project, which means that every day I will post that specifically stone on the social media and also send out newsletters so people can follow the project and see every day what stone I leave behind. That's one fun part of the project. What is also a really fun part is that the participants in the project mostly do not know how I painted their story or their message. So they will only see it on the day that I leave it on the trail. So it will be a positive surprise, I hope, for them when they see how I visualized the story. So that's how it starts off in Maastricht. And I hope, because it's really a very international trail, as I discovered in 2015, when I walked to France and Spain with the first project. So I hope the traveling stones will start off their journey there in France and then travel, for example, to Australia or somewhere else in Europe so that it will really take off. So this is me and my mobile workplace. I will use a backpack to carry out the project. And as you see at the bottom, there is the 101 miniature painted stones. It's 1.5 kilo that goes into my backpack. For the website and the database, I use my mobile device and a small traveling keyboard to do everything, because I hope a lot of things will happen with the stones and the project while I'm on the road. So this is how it will look. Okay, the project also, the most work in the project is the preparation, because most of the things are prepared at home, because when I'm with my backpack on the road, it's difficult to do a lot of work. So I painted everything, I labeled everything. For the new project, there are 300 web pages, because each stone has its own story and needs its own web page. Also because it's an international route. It's in Dutch, of course, but also translated in English and Spanish. So that is all waiting for me until April, and then it can take off, and then that will be a real present to do the project. So this, I will tell you now something more about the development of the project, which started in 2015 as a very easy thought of project, Project Stone. On the right, you see the route I walked of 1,450 kilometers, and it was the first art route with 61 miniature painted stones. Very easy. I painted the name of the website on the back. There were also 61 participants who followed the project, and their stories were hidden, so there was no webpage which shared their story. And on the left, you see some examples of the stones that I left for this project. Then in 2016, I walked the Flores 5 Trail, which is a national route from Amsterdam till Bergen op Zoom. And it was the first time that I used QR codes for the project, and I attached the stones and the QR project on the route. There were no participants. It was really a tryout. There were just small poems and miniature painted stones. And it was also a follow-up project. Then in 2017, it was really a big tryout, because I made an art route on the Pieterpad in the Netherlands with also QR codes and web links. And it was the first time that I used the traveling stones. So that was really exciting. Here you see how the stones look like. So there were remaining stones which were attached to poles on the route. So people could find them very easy. They were below the signals. And there were traveling stones. So 20 traveling stones. And I thought, well, what now if everybody who finds a traveling stone puts it in the pocket and that is it? You know, nothing happens. Maybe one of the stones will travel. That would be really great. So as I walked the route, 11 stones were relocated. I got new locations, and 2 stones were located abroad, of which this is one example. Maybe you know the place in the background. It's really great for a stone to get to a location like this. So this is a picture that one of the participants sent to me, because what I would love with this project is also to connect people through these stories and these miniature painted stones. And with this stone, that's what happened. So that was a great tryout and also a motivation for the new project this year, which I was already working on, knowing that this would be a very international trail and seeing the possibilities in further developing this project and with everything that comes with a project like this. So now I will tell you something about the digital background of this project, because I am a non-technical person when I started this. And in 2015, I had a portfolio website for my art, and it was very easy. It was a WordPress theme, which was a little bit customized, but that was also all I knew about programming and websites, so that's not a lot of stuff. And then in 2015, I carried out the project, and I made up the idea for the project as it will become this year. And I thought about, well, do I want to do this? So this is also very familiar for all of you. It's The Matrix, which was for me really a mind-blowing movie. And I was really curious about the reality behind the website and how it is made. So I thought, I want to know more about it. I want to learn how to code and how to build a website. And I was also maybe a little bit naive and thinking that it was possible, but I knew it would be difficult. But I just started doing this, and it was a really interesting journey for me. So one of the first things I did was get in contact with the hackerspace Tele Venlo in Venlo, because I knew it's not good to just be programming. So that's how it started. And as someone mentioned during the last talk, I started with Code Academy to learn HTML and CSS and to learn how to code. They offer a practice environment, but it's very basic, so it's very a standard environment. So I thought, well, I have the idea, I have the design of what I want my pages to look like. I will start working on the website straight away. So that's what I did. And then I learned about 10% of everything I know through Code Academy. The rest was Google and blogs. It was also talking to people at the hackerspace and Jelle, who helped me also a lot. And it was also by walking and getting out of the bubble in front of the screen and looking at the situation differently. And what I also discovered during this project is it's very important to be unique and to be yourself in doing a project like this. So for me, this meant hand painting 3 different backgrounds for the website, which I use. And this is my homepage for the desktop edition of the website, because I have very, well, it kind of got out of hand. Let's put it that way. Because being an artist and a perfectionist, it's like you can really get it can really get out of hand. So I ended up with 6,000 lines in my style sheet and 11 media queries. So it kind of got out of hand. But it was also fun. It's a really different way of thinking at it and a really different way of looking at what other people do. For example, the hamburger menu. I was like, oh, that's really amazing. I want this too. How do you do it? So I liked it. So this is how it started before I discovered ResponseNator. So it's like, yeah, you start from scratch, so you have to learn everything while doing it. So this is how it started building this website. Okay, so then so I built a complete front end, which was really great. And then someone told me, well, how do you want to do this, this GPS upload option? And how do you want to do security and the admin environment? How do you want to do it when you're walking with your backpack and you have to use the database? So I built the complete front end of the website with everything great. And then there was no back end. So this was, I think, the beginning of 2017. So Jelle Hendrikman helped me with importing the complete pages in WordPress as an own theme, which was also had some challenges, because everything changed, so I had to rebuild a lot. But it was also great, because I could use their admin and their security. It's like not possible for a project like this to do it yourself, unless you want to use it for future products. I also learned some PHP, SQL, JavaScript while doing this, so that was also great. And learned a lot of, I could use a lot of plugins, for example, OpenStreetMap, because I also have maps on the web pages on which you can see the journey of each stone. So that was fun, but it was also really difficult sometimes. It is a really challenging project. And then I talked to a friend, because when I walked in the Pieter Pad in 2017, it was really a lot of work. I used PHP Admin to get information. Well, I'm forgetting a step, sorry. Okay, when I walked the Floris Vrijf trail, I discovered that I needed a database, more extended database behind it, because a lot of things are connected and duplicated. I didn't know anything about it, so a friend explained to me what is a database and the structure about it, and I was really inspired. So I used Freeplane to design a database, and I use it, there's a mind mapping thing, and I use it also for creative ideas, because it can make connections. And this is the database, and then after that there were like a dozen changes to it, showing it to people and talking about it. So I used it for the first time in 2017 while laying out the art route on the Pieter Pad, and using PHP Admin. So that was also had some difficulties while using it on the road. So there were changes after that. Now I will be working with my own forms using Adminer when I'm laying out the new route in this year. So, well, April 1st I will be carrying out this project. I will be on the road for like 3.5, 4 months doing this project. I know it will be amazing, doing the last projects that I did, not just for me, which is real present to carry out a project like this, seeing the responses also when you're on the road talking about the project. But I'm also looking forward to what it will do. Will the stones travel? Where will they come? Will people upload photos? Will they give comments? What will it do? How will it affect people? Which is really a big part of the project, because the stories and messages behind it are sometimes inspiring, also personal. So what will this do for people? How will it affect them in a positive way? Doing this project, I also discovered that a hackerspace is a really creative environment, but in a different way, which is also really interesting, that you can use your mind in a creative way, but different than I was used to while just painting. And I really met some interesting and nice people there. So that's how it starts. I have already loads of ideas for this ongoing art project for the future, of course, but they have to wait. And I also have ideas for more future more technical projects, because when you're doing a project like this, and I was at the Hackerspace every Friday talking to people, they come with new ideas, and it's really like a boundary crossing thing on both sides. So currently I'm working on the Northern Light project, which is a project with different layers of acrylic glass and animated LED strips. So it will be a semi-transparent artwork, which also shows the Northern Light, and I hope it will be ready before I leave April 1st, but maybe that's a bit much to ask for, but that would be great. And I'm also working on another project, Inside the Box Outside, which works with semi-transparent glass and video, but that's also, we'll see about that. This is the summary of my whole talk, actually. So this is not a technical story, but I really discovered that it's beneficial and interesting to cross the borders, not just physically walking abroad, which is also very interesting, but also meeting technical people and doing a project like this and discovering this whole new world. And it also it confirmed my belief in how walking helps you in every way, not just for your art, but also for looking for solutions for technical projects. Just like I'm standing before you here today, which is very difficult because I'm not technical and you all are probably. I don't think that the fear of doing something should stop you, unless it's really a fear like, don't jump up off a cliff, for example, but just do it. So these are some of the lessons that I learned. I also think that, especially with the Camino Stones project, which was really a dream for me. I think you should follow your dreams and try to make it realized, because when you do it, you discover it's even better than what you thought of before. So, and these are my contact informations if you want to know more about the project or something. Yes. That was it. Are there questions?
Hello. Yeah. Are you going to extend it in other countries as well? Because I live in Sweden, and maybe the northern part of the Europe could be interesting as well.
Or the St. Olaf's Trail, for example.
Yeah, for example, yes. King's Path. Yeah.
I'm thinking also, but then I think it will take maybe 2 years to prepare, because it's a lot of work. But when you're walking the trail, you meet a lot of people and you learn about different interesting trails. So one trail I'm really interested in is also a trail in Japan, the 88 Temple Trail. So I'm interested in that. And then I was on the walking and cycling fair, and I met some people of the St. Olaf's Trail, which has also a very interesting historical site. So yes, that's maybe for the future interesting. Yes.
You can extend it by...
Yeah, that's why I asked.
Yes. Oh, yes. Yes. Yes, I forgot to tell you this, because I have the GPX files of the art routes are on my website for free. So if you are interested in walking, you can walk parts of the route, and there are also the locations of the stones, or you can walk the complete route, which is also very interesting. But you can find the stones, and if you do, I would love you to respond to it. Yes.
Okay.
So it's an invitation.
Go.
Okay. Okay, are there more questions?
How much kilometers a day are you going to walk now for the new trail?
From I don't know exactly, but normally my ideal distance is 27, 28 kilometers, also depending on what the day is like, because when you have like a day that you walk a lot of mountains, things will slow up. But that's like my ideal distance, and then I walk for 2 weeks, one resting day, and then that's like the ideal.
Okay, thank you.
Have you ever, in the previous project, get feedback from people who find the stones and in the right moment or something like that?
Yes, it's really great because already in the first project, which was a project with hidden stories, and also sometimes the stones were hidden. It's really not like this. Then one stone of me in France was found, and the person responded through my website. So it didn't have its own website. And it was also was really a great story, because on the stone there was painted like the rose and a question mark. And this person was walking the trail, it's a pilgrimage trail, just that day wondering about what will I do with my life, and then found this stone with a question mark and found a solution. So it was really like this story, this is what I want to do with my life, your stone will get a very special place in this, and it's really inspirational for me, and also for the person who was attached to the stone, to get this response. And then for the Pieter Pad, I had some responses through social media and the website, but that was really in 2015 like a big story, mm-hmm. Yes, big response.
Okay, thank you.
And the traveling stone, what is the furthest distance that your stones have traveled until now?
Yes, I only executed carried out that part in 2017 with 20 stones. So two stones went abroad, one to Stonehenge, and one stone traveled to the north of Italy, and then to the Gardameer. So those two stones are the farthest. But then, as I discovered in 2015, while walking this international trail, you meet people from, like, example, Australia, Canada, America, more people than I expected. Also from Europe, different people. So I'm really curious about what it will do this year. Yeah. Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Do you get any funding for this these projects, or what do you live off?
Well, for the projects, the participants in the project paid me a fee. This pays for part of the project, so they paid me a fee to participate with the story or message. But it was really a lot of time investment to realize this. And so I don't want to do it like that again. So what I now did was put a funding button on my website. Like, you can support this project. I'm also looking into other options. I don't want to do it like this, because it really takes up a lot of time. And also I would love to, how should I say it? Make two things of it, like funding the project and then people donating their stories for free. I would love it to be two parts of the project when it's possible.
Did you think about crowdfunding?
Yes, I thought about it, but there are also some disadvantages for this project attached to it. For example, yeah. The problem is, I started this project about 2 years ago, getting the participants. And then when you step into crowdfunding, there are some strange strings attached to it. And I was really like, it's my project, I want to do it this way, you know? I didn't want to do it, yeah. There's a lot of investment since I started it in 2015, so maybe for the future projects, it is an interesting option, because I do not want to do it like this anymore. Yes. Thank you.